Hi everyone. So today we'll start creational design patterns. Basically, if you look at the syllabus, we continue with the design and development principles. And I'm actually going to use a textbook, a standard in the field called Head First Design Patterns. Okay. So basically, we'll start with understanding what design patterns are and how to use them, basically. And we can use them in different ways. We can recognize design patterns. We can recognize situations in which we need that kind of design patterns. And we can also apply them as solutions to those situations when we recognize those type of design patterns. Okay. So really today we'll start with the talk about what are design patterns and what are they used for. So a design pattern is the description to a problem and its solutions that you can apply to many similar situations. And it's really, it has to do with problems that need to be solved and the best solutions that can be applied for that type of problem, okay? So basically design patterns facilitate the reuse of good and tested solutions, and they are agnostic to programming languages. As you saw in the post that I put on Piazza to one of your questions, you need design patterns in any programming language. There are textbooks of how to use design patterns in Java, in Python, in JavaScript, and so on. And it's really about the design. You recognize a problem. For instance, you need an object a single time and you need the same object. One hardcore solution is to just pass that reference to that object as a parameter. Another possible solution is to create a static class, but it has drawbacks. Like for instance, static classes cannot be inherited. You can't create a subclass of a static class. Also, you can modify it through inheritance, adding parameters, adding features, okay? So it's really a design problem and a way to solve that type of design problem that you have at a given time. And why is this important? It is important that you basically become a better programmer if you understand the problem and the solution that maps to that type of problem. And you will start recognizing these common design patterns in other people's code, including public APIs like JavaScript, Java, Python APIs. If you work in a project with other team members, you will recognize the design patterns that they are using. You will also find out that there are different design patterns applied to different architectures. Like for instance, GUI architectures use certain type of design patterns. Web patterns also use design patterns. Architectural patterns like the ones in JavaScript use certain design patterns. And you will learn how to apply them to your own code. So you will get a problem. You will recognize that this is a problem that matches the description of that design pattern. And you will start using exactly the same kind of design pattern and then code it as dictated by that design pattern. And some design patterns can be implemented in many different ways. I will show you examples, for instance, today from singleton design pattern that can be implemented with early init, lazy init, enumerations, and so on. So basically you have multiple options and you will choose which one best fits the kind of problem that you have. The greatest advantage of design patterns is that last time I told you, when we talk about design, features cannot be deleted from code because people are already using those features. But still you want to easily update your code. And the advantage of design patterns is that it lets you actually, usually through object-oriented programming, to update the code, maintain applications by doing inheritance, implementing subclasses, implementing the same standardized interfaces, and update your code without having to modify the pre-existing code, okay? there are many different design patterns. And in this class, we'll cover three types of design patterns. Creational design patterns, that's the topic of the class today. Structural design patterns and behavioral design patterns. We'll start with creational design patterns. What kind of patterns you will see in standard code for creating objects? And all of you may actually say at this time that you took CSC 114, 214, and you know that objects are created through the new operator. No, you need a new application in JavaFX, you will create a new object of that type. But in some cases, you want to actually have some kind of limitations. Like for instance, you don't want, let's take for instance, the factory design pattern. You have a large pool of different types of objects or different type of classes that implement the same interface. You don't want to learn every single type individually, edge border, title border, strong border, and so on. You will have to learn only one design, one interface, border interface with its methods, and then the factory, border factory, a factory that builds all of the type of borders that implement the border interface. Okay, so a factory basically builds objects, usually in the same family. This is the same idea that we have in software development, in which you have a factory object that creates instances of every one of the type of cars or every one of the type of borders that you need. Okay. Singleton is another kind of pattern, design pattern that you will see in many cases. When you want to have a single object of a certain class, like for instance, you are implementing a game and you want the state of the game to be accessible everywhere by every single object. Maybe you have threaded application, multiple processors, but you want every single time, no matter which thread calls, to take the same object to update the state or to visualize the state. So singleton design pattern is the best design pattern for that. And basically what you are doing, you have a private constructor and a method that gets you that same object no matter how many times you invoke it. So first time it checks if you have a static reference, if that is different than null. If it's null, it creates the object and returns the reference to it. But every single time you call that method again, because the object is not null, it gives you the same reference back. You can also think of web servers. So you want the web server to give you the result back. Every single time you invoke the operating system, the operating system will give you the same web server back, because basically it's a singleton object. It waits to be used by anyone. Okay, so the singleton design pattern is a design pattern that allows you to always get the same one object out of a type. Now, the truth is that it's not always singleton. Sometimes you have a pool of available objects, and it's also an example of singleton, but it's not quite a singleton. You don't have a single object that you return all the time. You have a pool of objects and you return one of the elements in that pool to customers. So it's the same idea of this singleton design pattern. The builder design pattern. The builder design pattern is used when you want to build a big object that has multiple steps in the creation of that object. And you don't want to expose methods that makes that object mutable. So you want, once it's created, you want it to be basically immutable, unchangeable, okay? So the builder design pattern lets you actually build incrementally staging of that object. And once you are happy with this draft, you build the object. But once you build the object, it cannot be changed. So the builder design pattern actually encapsulates the construction of a complex object that needs multiple steps to be created entirely. And once it's created, nobody can modify it. It's like if you have a very complex, let's say a game that the bots are extremely complex, you have to add additional all kinds of features to them. But once you want to create them, you create them in one step, although internally you executed multiple steps to create them. The prototype design pattern, you can think of cloning to be the example of prototype design pattern. So let's assume that you have a pool of objects and you want to create from that pool a small pool of objects, like three objects. And out of that pool, you want to create multiple copies of every one of those objects. Okay. So the prototype design pattern tells you that you have a pool of prototypes, basically these individual objects. And when you need one of those type of objects, one kind of those objects, you just clone that existing already object. So it's really about cloning, nothing else. That's what the prototype design pattern is. That instead of creating it with a new operator, you actually copy the memory location into another memory location and you give a reference to it. So it's all about cloning. Like instead of actually using the internal programming language structure to create an object, you copy a block of memory. And this is much faster than actually running the Java code or Python code or JavaScript code to actually create that object. So cloning is usually much faster than running code because you copy a block of memory. So we'll start with details in factory design pattern and singleton builder and prototype. So the factory design pattern is named for factories. Factories make stuff like cars or fridges or dishwashers, okay? And they usually make multiple types within the same class. So factory classes make objects, again, within a certain kind. And your question again is, shouldn't constructors do that? And the answer is yes, usually use the new operator, no matter that you do it in Java or Python or JavaScript, you actually create an object with a builder or a constructor. Internally, factory classes actually use these constructors, but you want to hide how you invoke that constructor. Sometimes the constructor is private and you want to prevent misuse of that constructor. You don't want to give access to everyone to that constructor. You want to give access to a certain method that that checks the arguments for any type of the constructors within a certain kind. So factory pattern, actually the point of factory patterns is to prevent misuse, improper construction of objects, hiding the entire construction. You don't need to have actually that constructor as a public method. Provide API convenience. You have one method to create an object in a large pool of different kind of objects. It's like a one-stop shop to get one type of objects. And to understand exactly what I mean, think that you have multiple objects in the same family. You have one common ancestor with the same apparent type and different actual types. And I can give you examples from the Java programming language, Java Swing, for instance, where there are many different kind of borders. And actually here is a list of all the classes that implement the interface border in the Swing framework. So you see there are about 30 to 50 different classes that implement borders, menu borders, split pane borders, etched borders, 3D borders, metal borders, button borders, and so on. So you don't want to learn all of these different classes. You actually want to have one factory that, given that you know what type of border you need, you can invoke it to get that type of border. And the advantage is that you only have to import this factory, border factory, and then you can create any type of border that you already know. So they all return, this method returns the same apparent type, basically the interface border, but you can actually specify here where I have XXX, what type of border you want. Do you want create a bevel border, create an edge border, create a strong border, create a button border, 3D border, and so on. There are many different other factory classes, usually to do with security. Like for instance, Java Security Key Factory. So given one specific algorithm for generating keys, you can invoke that algorithm in this key factory. So you can basically get an SSH key, an open SSH key with a different size, and so on. And similarly for certificates, signing certificates, as like DSA, you can actually just use this Java Security Cert certificate factory and get any type of certificate implemented in internal in Java. So really the advantage is that you only need to know one factory class, in this case, the border factory class, and the type of the border that you want to create. When you import, you will only import border factory and the border interface, because you need the type of that object that you will import. Okay, and let me show you an example. So the border factory that I mentioned in Java Swing has many different methods, has create bevel border, many different create bevel borders, create compound border, create dashed border. And in fact, there are, because there are about 30 different borders, 30 to 50, and each one of them has four or five methods, you can imagine that this class, the border factory, has about 100 different create methods to create these kind of borders. Okay. And here I have a simple example. Basically, all that you need to do is to import border factory, and I can actually show it to you in Java. So here I have Eclipse already implemented, and all that I needed to import was border factory and border. And then I can create any type of border that I want, etched border, titled border, and so on. And I can run it. And here is basically my graphical user interface. It has two borders I created. One was titled and the other one was etched. So it's really a straightforward way to use from a family of classes, only two classes, the interface that all of these actual classes are implementing and the factory class, which basically generates objects from the entire family. That's what the factory is. Okay, and the entire example that I showed you is in the lecture notes. Basically, the use of a border, a factory in Java, in Java Swing. Okay, now your question is how to implement a factory pattern, and this is the example that exactly what I just did, but straightforward. You create an interface like border. Then you have multiple actual classes that implement that interface, etched border, titled border. And if that interface requires to implement certain a certain set of methods, abstract methods, you must implement them because basically you are implementing that interface. Then the border factory per se will basically allow you to create multiple of these classes. You only have, if this is in a separate file, you only have to import the border interface because everything else is basically implemented in the border factory. So, and etch border and title border and so on. So basically you have the methods to create the different kind of borders. And then in your main method, I will actually show you this working. You're just basically importing the border factory and then the border interface. So I also have this implemented right here. So I basically have the interface border, multiple classes that implement that one interface, and I have the border factory. So now, again, if I want to use, I don't need to know about all of the different classes, and there can be hundreds of such classes to implement the border interface. I only have to know about the border factory per se. So let me actually show you an example. So we can call it factory test. And now because I'm in the same package, CSC316, I can just use it directly. So border B1 is factory, border factory. And I can get create edge border. And similarly, I have another, I want another border, a titled border, border B2. and create title border, and without what whatever title I want. Okay. So the advantage is that I don't actually need to import different classes, and I can basically just use one stop shop for the kind of object that I want. I don't need to actually import different classes and use different classes. Now, what are the advantages? Basically, again, as a programmer, you never need to know the actual class type. It simplifies the use. You will use just the factory class, fewer classes to learn. For that example that you saw before, one only needs to know the border and border factory, not every kind of border. They only need to know what they want to use, and that's it. Now, another larger example is think of cars. So again, in order to remember factory design pattern, you should try to map it to something that is intuitive to you. And cars are basically built by factories, okay? So again, you can have an interface or an abstract class car. Then you can have basically different classes that implement car, BMW, BMW 320, Toyota, Corolla, Toyota Camry, and so on. Then you have a factory class, which basically has a create car method. And then even this is, it's actually extending what we learned from the previous case, that there is an abstract class factory, and then that is implemented by a BMW subclass of factories. So it actually extends the use case that we saw before, that we don't actually need anymore to modify the factory class. We can implement a subclass, also a factory class that is a subclass of the car factory class. So now another feature that I actually employ here, which you'll learn about later, is that moreover, you don't actually need to always implement methods, separate methods for the different types. You can use a string to specify what type do you want out of that entire family of types of objects. So this is actually called a command pattern, also a design pattern that we'll actually learn about next class. So in the command pattern, you are actually encoding as a string in a canonical form, like for instance, a string that says the type of the class that you want to create, the type of the class. So one note that I would like to make here, and I will update the slides later when I update them on the website, is that we actually do two more things here. So one is the fact that the factory can use inheritance. So you have one abstract car factory, and then you, instead of modifying that class, updating that class, adding methods for every one type of subclass, you actually implement a subclass of that abstract car factory class, like the BMW factory. And there is where you actually implement the methods for the different type of cars that you want to return. And the second note that I want to make here is that you also employ the command design pattern. So the command design patterns basically states that you pass as a string. Let me actually continue here. The type of class that you want to create. Okay. So the advantage is really the fact that you don't need to create any more multiple methods. You can have one method and specify what type of car you want. I want to create the BMW, or I want to create the BMW 320. Okay. So again, as a user, if this is a dealer class, you can create different car objects, but without having to invoke new BMW or new BMW 320 or whatever other types of BMW are available. You can just use the BMW factory and create the type of car that you want. So you don't need to actually use the constructor that is provided in that class. Okay. And again, I have it working in Java. Let me actually show it to you. This is the dealer class with a multiple type of cars, the BMW factory, and I basically can create multiple objects, one BMW 320 and one BMW, by just using the BMW factory create car method. So I don't need to invoke the constructor for the different type of classes. Okay. So that's the creational design pattern. So it's the creational factory design pattern. Okay. The next type of design pattern that we cover today is the singleton design pattern. So singleton design pattern is used for those kind of applications where you have a single central app that you always want to get hold of, like a basic web server, an FTP server. It's a single object that runs on that machine and is waiting for, like for instance, for requests on some network socket, okay? So you want that kind of application servers, especially to be a singleton class, an object that if somebody wants to create another one, they should be told, no, you can't, that socket is already in use. There is a server waiting for a request there. So you can get always a copy of that server, okay? So also is used for something that everybody needs. Like for instance, if you develop a game, you don't want to pass around the state from every thread to every single method, or you don't want the logging service. You have log4j in Java or some logging service on a server. You want everybody to have access to it without having to pass a reference to that object around as a method argument. Okay. So the advantage is really for the singleton pattern that it don't want to pass it as a parameter. We want always a method that gives us the same object. Okay. So how can we implement this? The singleton design pattern can be implemented by creating a private constructor and then a method that returns the same static object all the time. So no matter who invokes it, what thread, when invokes it, it always gets the same object. That's the entire definition of the singleton design pattern. And here is an example. Properties manager defines the singleton data field, static data field property of the type properties manager, has a private constructor, and then we have a public method, get properties manager. If that singleton static property is null, then actually create a new object of the type properties manager and return the singleton object. So now it doesn't matter when we call it. We call it at the beginning, we get an object, we call it again. It checks if this singleton, which is in the global segment of memory, so available to everyone, is different than null. And if it's different than null, it skips the creation and just returns the reference. So basically you always get the same object, okay? Now, this kind of implementation of singleton design pattern is preferable to a fully static class. Earlier I told you that you can also implement a static class. And what that means is that it actually creates an instance in the global segment of memory, at least in Java, for that class, because basically that's the idea of a static class. But now if you do have a static class created in the global segment of memory, you can't extend it. There is, Java has this requirement that a static class cannot be extended. Now, sometimes you'll also want to use it as a method argument. For static classes, it's not, you can't get the reference because it is a static class. So you can use it, that object from memory, but you cannot get the reference to it. So you can't pass it as a parameter around. So it's not preferred to actually do this kind of static classes, fully static classes, and use the static class. It's preferable to use this pattern, the singleton design pattern. Okay. So let me show you this example. So, oops, properties manager, this singleton object that I created, and I always return. I have a main method, and P1 is the object of the type properties manager, and I get a reference to it from the properties manager, get properties manager. And I do the same for P2, and I can do it on many different threads. I can do it from a different class, but I will always get the same object. If you look at the hash code that is returned by printing the object, you will see that it is the same. So it doesn't matter how many times I will invoke this to get that properties manager object, I will get the same object all the time, because basically it looks if the object is already created, and if it is, it gives me the same reference. That's the whole idea of singleton design pattern. Always get the same reference to the object that you need. So this is that example. Basically, you can create multiple property managers, and it's basically the same design, the same property manager. So now other classes can easily use your property manager, because they can always get, no matter, I don't have to be in this class. I can be in the same package in a different class. I can basically get the same properties manager. So the advantage is that I can basically get the same properties manager no matter where I run on what thread. Okay. You don't have to worry passing objects around. You don't have to worry about the object consistency, because you always get the same object. Now, this same idea is, it's again available in public APIs. So for instance, in Java, when you run the JVM, the Java Virtual Machine, there is a method get runtime. And this returns an object associated with the current Java application. Most of the methods in this class runtime are instance methods and must be invoked with respect to this runtime method, runtime object. So again, if you need to get a copy of the runtime, you don't need to invoke the new operator, because that gives you, actually it's private, so it doesn't give you anything, but it would give you another object of the current runtime if it would be public. But you can always get a copy of the runtime, okay? And the same copy of the runtime. So this is API example. So I create multiple R1 and R2 copies of the runtime. And again, if I print them, I will basically see that it is the same runtime. So no matter how many times I call it and from what part of the code, I will get the same runtime object. And the same with in the AWT, which is another Java graphical user interface framework, you can get the current desktop and all the properties of the current desktop, the size, width and height of the current desktop. You can get where is basically Java currently available in that current desktop and so on. So basically this desktop is also a singleton method. It always returns to you the same desktop in a JVM. And again, the code is available and you can try it and you will see that these are singleton classes. You will basically get the same object no matter how many times you invoke them. So you can get different values. You can get the available processors from the runtime. So you basically know if you create threads to run your application concurrently or in parallel, you can basically decide on how many threads you want to create so that they are always scheduled on some processor. Okay. Now, how to implement singleton? There are different ways to implement singleton. So one version of implementing singleton is an eager init. An eager init is basically when you create that static object reference in instance, you actually also create the object. So it avoids calling that if statement all the time when actually you return an instance of this singleton class. The type of initialization that you've seen before in my previous example is called a lazy init, basically where you don't create it when you actually in the static global segment when during runtime, at the beginning when you actually compile the program,
you actually created the moment that is invoked for the first time. So you basically call get instance sync, which is a synchronized method. Only one thread can get into that method at any given time. So basically this entire code is synchronized, so only one method can actually get in. And then you are basically getting the object. You create the object and you're getting the instance. In either one of these cases, if you basically create, call the method get instance or get instance synchronized, you get basically the object. So in fact, you can even mix them. You can have eager init, but also have the synchronized init. In either case, you will basically get exactly the same object. This is a singleton pattern. So it's one object of that class, no many than one. And here I have an example where I create two objects, S1 and S2, with get instance. And if I print the hash code, it prints basically the same number because basically it's the same object. Another way to implement singleton is with an enumeration where there is a single value in the enumeration. So no matter what value, when you basically want to get that value, enumerations in Java also allow methods. So you can basically get that value, a singleton value from that enumeration and the corresponding method for that one value, okay? So this is something that some people actually like because you are getting directly the object without having to create it. But basically it's a little bit less used because it requires enumerations. So let me show you this examples. So here is the example. Basically, I have the eager init version of instance with the corresponding method that always gives you the same instance variable because it's already created. The alternative lazy init, in which I get basically the instance for the first time using the synchronized method, and that creates the instance. And then every single thread will get the same object no matter when it calls. You can see one feature that the constructor is private. So that's the whole point of not being able to call it from a different class. I have the enumeration that I showed you before and the main method, which basically uses the lazy init, the synchronized method, but I can use either one of them. And if I run it, you will basically see that the hash code is the same. So the object is in fact the same object, okay? Because the hash code in this case is in fact the address in the virtual space of memory. So that's singleton design pattern. The next type of design pattern, and feel free at any time to ask me questions.
Could you explain, why they enumerate? What's the point of the enumeration?
It's another way to implement this design pattern. So really, the enumeration contains a single individual. So instead of using a constructor to create that individual like we did for new singleton here, I already, in enumerations, you already get that option, that object. It's not quite an object but you can use it as an object.
Oh, so it creates Elvis, an object called Elvis?
By default. So you see that when you are invoking that Elvis, you don't need to actually, I never did anywhere a new construct. I didn't actually create the object because enumerations, or the object already exists in that enumeration. Is it clear?
Okay, it makes sense. It just already exists. We don't have to call anything.
Exactly. Like for instance, here we had to choose between eager init or lazy init. In the case of that enumeration, I don't have to do anything because I can only get the only object that is in the enumeration. Okay, good. So builder design pattern. So
the builder is a design pattern that is used to encapsulate the construction of a complex object, like usually that requires multiple steps to build it, okay? And it allows it to be constructed in steps, but when you construct it finally, you get an immutable object. So it's good for constructing complex objects that require a lot of customization. And as an example, I give you an example, a vacation planner. Like after the COVID ends, hopefully we'll all be happy to travel again and have a big celebration of this being over. So basically, if you ever went on a vacation, you will know that there are many things that you have to plan. The hotel, the tickets for the flight or the train, the events that you want to take part in, the meals, certain other types of travel. Once I remember that I traveled to Europe and I had to go to LaGuardia, which was quite complex because LaGuardia doesn't have a fast air train. So I had to find how to get to the train station from Stony Brook, how to get to, from the, through the train to Jamaica, from Jamaica to take a bus, from that bus to actually fly to Hamburg, and from there to Munich. And from there, I had to take a train to Karlsruhe and so on. So there are many different steps that you need to do. And some guests want zero of any of some instances or many of those instances. Like in my case, I had 8 or 10 different steps into my round trip travel, for instance. And you want to create a plan builder to encapsulate all of this information incrementally. And once you are satisfied with the plan, to create the plan, okay? And it's kind of like this, like basically, especially when you are going on a vacation, there are multiple days. Every day you have to think about hotel, park tickets, dining, special events, and so on. So basically you have to build incrementally some big object or a complex plan, and then to basically customize every single step. So what's the problem? Basically, you want lots of customization. Some customers may want a hotel, some want multiple rooms because they probably meet their parents there. Some want restaurant reservations throughout many days, maybe multiple in the same days because you need lunch, dinner. We need basically a flexible data structure that can represent the guest planners and their variations, and also to build this object in steps. Okay. And usually it's built again through inheritance. So you have an abstract or a client class, which basically uses a builder. Usually this is using an abstract interface or abstract class builder. And then you implement the different type of builder that you want, a vacation builder for a certain type of vacation, or you want a vacation builder to Disneyland or a vacation builder to Alaska and so on. So depending on the type, you want a different type of builder. And you can think about these applications like Expedia, that they have internally something like this, because when you are trying to build a vacation for a certain type of trip, it will give you methods relevant to that trip, to that kind of trip. If you want to travel to Mexico, it will give you options for travel in Mexico, events in Mexico, places to visit in Mexico, and so on. But I will show you a simpler example, because really you have to learn this interface through a simple example, and then we can apply it to that larger example of a vacation builder. So let's assume that we want to create a user for a certain system. Like for instance, I want to create a user for Solar, Stony Brook Solar. And we don't know all the properties of the user. Like for instance, if I know myself, I know my first name, last name, age, phone number, address, and so on. So some of the properties are optional.
but I want this creator to be an immutable object. So once I create it with everything that I know, I don't want it to be modified. Okay. And you can think that there are many applications of this. Maybe you're a bank and you don't want your clerks or some malicious clerk to modify the customer data. Similar, if you are a university, you want to create a student object and you don't want somebody to change the ID of the student, or the, you want the object to be immutable. Okay. But since some of the properties are optional, you can already think that there are many different constructors. A constructor that takes the first name and the last name, we don't know anything else. A constructor that takes the first name, last name, and age. A constructor that takes first name, last name, age, and phone. And every other subset of the optional fields. So you will have an exponential number of constructors, because for every single field, it's even there or not. And then you have to have all these possible constructors. One that has every single possible combination of fields. So this is a valid option, but of course it gives you an exponential number of constructors and code application. So you don't really want such constructors, or you basically want one way to build it. And once it's built, a straightforward, a simpler way to build it and create it. And then you have a construct, an immutable object. So this is where the builder pattern solution comes in. So let me actually show you the builder. So first you have an inner class builder, which allows you to customize the fields. So you have the required fields, first name and last name, and then you have the optional fields, age, phone number, address. And this is really, you can think of this as having mutator methods for every one of the fields. So you have the required field to build a user given the required fields like first name and last name. And then you have a method age to assign the age and return the new builder, a method phone to assign the phone and return the new builder, and so on. So really this inner class allows you incrementally to build the object until you are satisfied. And then you have the actual class. And moreover, once you are satisfied, you can actually build the object. So you can invoke the constructor of the outer class, the user class, with this builder, the current builder in mind, okay? So this is where the builder pattern comes into play, that you have an outer class, the user, which is the public class that you show to final users, which has all of the fields that I mentioned above, including the ones that are optional. Then you have the constructor that takes as an input the user builder, the inner class, that allowed us to actually build this object incrementally. But once that inner the user decides that inner class builds the object incrementally and I'm done with building the object, I basically transfer the fields from the builder to the actual user object. So really the inner object was just used to create the object incrementally. But then once I create it, you can see I don't have mutators anymore. I have only accessors that give me the various properties like name, last name, first name, last name, age, and so on. So the builder pattern is actually an inner class that allows you to build incrementally using mutators the draft of the object that you want to create. And then when you are happy with it, to actually build the outer object out of the inner object. And you can see that actually you can get this user incrementally. So you can create a new user by using the user builder internally, and you can give the name and first name and last name, the age by invoking the, and actually here we are using this idea of streaming. So I created a user builder, on that I'm adding the age, I'm adding the phone, I'm adding the address, and then when I'm happy, I build it. So that gives me the outer object that is basically totally built out of these incremental steps. And moreover, You can even make the user constructor, the constructor for the class, as private. So exactly like in the case of the factory pattern, you have a exposed method getUser that allows you to build the user incrementally, but you don't need to expose the API of creating the user, the constructor API, or this inner builder class, the one that is used for building incrementally the object. Okay. So really the advantage of this is that you want that you can create incrementally an object that is immutable, but you have many different optional fields. So you can't create, you can generate an exponential number of constructors. Like in this case would be 2 to the power 3 different constructors, because you have all of the options of mixing the different fields, age, phone number, address, in any possible order, in any possible combination, subset. Okay. So the builder benefits is that it encapsulates a way to construct a complex object. It allows objects to be constructed multi-step incrementally. Like for instance, I created the inner object, like my user or a trip, and then I'm adding one by one the travels, the hotels, the events, the plans, and so on. And once I'm happy, I basically, in one step, I can basically create the object that I need, like in the factory pattern. It hides the internal representation of the product. So in our case, the builder object, and you can swap through inheritance the actual product implementations. So again, you can use on top of this inheritance and actually implementing an abstract interface and implementing various methods of builder. And for the vacation builder, I will not go into much detail, but it's basically the same idea that you have all the fields private with multiple people, hotel reservations, other type of reservations, activities, and you can incrementally add features, like add a person, set the hotel, set the reservation, add activity, show everything that you have up to now, and also add activities, hotels, persons with their own properties, and then reservations, and then you have the vacation builder. So is a vacation builder that has a builder that is a private data. You can incrementally start adding a new vacation, add persons, hotel, activities to this builder. And only when you're happy, when you're done, you can basically create the object and return the actual vacation object. And this is the entire code. Again, you can actually try to run it and you will learn by testing it and modifying it if you want to update, add some activities and so on. Okay. So that's the idea of the builder creational design pattern. Go ahead.
So basically we create a mutable class and then we use that mutable class to create an immutable class?
Exactly.
Or object?
Very good point. So you create a draft that is mutable, and once you're happy, it's finalized, you actually generate the object that is immutable. And actually this requirement is, there is no requirement that the object that you create in the end is immutable. Because if you think again about the vacation, by the time you are finalized with adding so many different, activities, hotel, and you're happy with the price, you probably are also fed up with the entire process. So you will want to create it and be done with it. And actually the other point is that nowadays there is no concept of reservation. Reservation for a trip really means that you are creating incrementally some plan, but only when you are purchasing the ticket or the entire plan, you pay the money. So that's why it's immutable, because you already paid for it and you usually don't get a rebate back or some kind of like a cancellation money back.
Okay, that makes sense.
Okay, the creational prototype design pattern. So I will start with an example, and I don't know how many of you saw the Minions movie. So the Minions movie are these basically Disney characters that all look the same, mostly the same. They actually have two or three individuals, and they make copies, multiple copies of those individuals. So that's exactly the idea of what the prototype factory is. So let's say that you are the designer of the movie, the software that implements this 3D movie, okay? And you implement an interface minion with a method clone, and then you implement multiple subclass of minions. So Stuart implements minion, Kevin implements minion, Bob implements minion, and each one of them has its clone method and other methods like toString. They return Stuart, Kevin, and banana in the case of Bob. So basically, you have an interface and three different objects that implement that interface. Now, I want to actually create a lab of hundreds of minions in the movie or the game that I develop. So I create a hash map. And in this hash map, I basically put prototypes, a prototype for Stuart with the key Stuart, a prototype for Kevin with the key Kevin, a prototype for Bob with the key Bob. Okay, so now it doesn't matter how many objects I need. Maybe I need 100 minions. I basically will invoke the make object method. So the make object method, in my case, takes a string, but you can really iterate over all the arguments that you pass up as parameters. You want to create three Kevins, two Bobs, and five Stewarts. So the advantage of prototype is that you don't actually invoke the constructor anymore. You invoke them when you actually created the first batch of prototypes, one object of each, and then you just copy. You copy an entire block of memory, which is a much faster operation. You can think about it as arithmetical operations versus arithmetical shifts. So for instance, you want to multiply with 16. It's much faster if you shift right with 4 bits than actually multiplication with 16. And similarly, you want to multiply with 2 and so on. Byte operations or bit operations are much faster than actual Java constructors or any kind of Java code that needs to be executed. That's the entire idea of prototype pattern. So in prototype pattern, you want actually to create objects out of already existing prototypes. And the idea is that you actually don't execute any Java source code. You are actually just making copies in memory. And I can give you another example. Let's say that you develop a CAD application to design a garden or to design a park, and you have hundreds of trees in that park. So one way to do it is to create an instance of every one tree. Another way to do it is to create an instance of tree and then copy it many, many different times, 100 different times. And that's the idea of prototype pattern, that you create one instance for every object, and then you can copy that instance into using bit operations, just simple cloning operations. So that's the idea of prototype pattern. In fact, you don't even, in many cases, you don't even have to create the clone. You can just keep an array of how many objects you kept, you created of that specific prototype. So basically, you don't need actually to create these copies out of the prototypes. But that's the prototype pattern. It's a pattern where you want an instance of a given class that is expensive or complicated to create. And the textbook that I mentioned earlier, the HATS first design patterns, gives you a big example, but you don't need to actually, if you know what is on the lecture notes, is basically all that I want you to know from design patterns. But the textbook gets into a complicated example where you have an endless chain of foes in a game, and each kind of foe is specialized for the type of environment where you are, like sea monsters or bird-like monsters and so on. And instead of actually creating a new monster out of the current situation, you can actually just clone the existing type of monsters that you have in that specific environment. Okay. So the problem is that you decouple the code that handles the details of creating monsters from the actual code that needs them on the fly, because you just create copies of already existing objects using bit operations. So that's what the prototype patterns allows you to make new instances by copying existing instances. Okay. And in Java, this is usually done through the clone method. But in other languages, you can basically do bit copies of memory. So in C, for instance, or C++, you can directly copy a block of memory without even knowing what is inside. Because when you deserialize it, you can actually, you know what you already copied in that block. So again, you can use inheritance for this. So you can use an interface monster. In our example, we had the interface minion, and then different type of monsters. You have constructors that create those specific type of monsters. And then when you clone them, you just clone the object corresponding to that environment. And the type of the monster that you get is the interface monster. So you don't even have to remember the entire hierarchy of the different type of monsters that you have. You just need to clone the appropriate objects. So the benefits are that it hides the complexity of making new instances, because all that you do, you clone blocks of memory. It also provides the option for the client to generate objects whose type is not known at the time when you actually create them. So because you copy blocks of memory, you don't actually care what is in that block. The renderer has to actually deserialize the object and know what type of the object is. So in most circumstances, not in some, but in most circumstances, copying objects is more efficient than creating new objects. So the prototype pattern is used when you want new objects of many different types in a complex hierarchy. And it does it very efficiently by copying blocks of memory. A drawback may be that copying objects is sometimes complicated. And you can think of the fact that in Java, and all of you should know this, there are deep cloning and shallow cloning. So deep cloning is when the properties, if they are references, they are also cloned. Shallow cloning is that you only copy the block of that certain object. You don't, if you have references as data fields, they are still pointing to the same common objects, common parts in memory. So you should always think about, is this a deep cloning method? And if it is, if it's not, try to do it as a deep cloning method, because you may have to, you change a parameter for one of the monsters, like the height of the monsters is 6 yards instead of 2 yards. Now, if you had shallow cloning, all of your monsters become bigger. So basically, you should basically think of what type of cloning do you have in your program. And that's basically all about creational design patterns. Next class will cover structural design patterns, which are a little bit more complicated. And then in the end, we'll cover behavioral design patterns, which are about dynamic properties of objects. So today we only cover the creational design patterns, the basic design patterns for creating objects on the fly, and basically are alternatives to constructors, but for specific uses, like factory, you want an object in a big set of type of objects. Singleton, you always want the same copy without having to pass it as a parameter. Builder, that you want to build some object incrementally, and only when you're satisfied, pay the price of building that object. and prototype is that you use cloning to get copies of different objects in memory. Okay. And that's all for today. Any questions?
Right. So prototype is like kind of like creating a forest, but you're just copying a bunch of trees into it.
Exactly.
And they're all the same trees. That's it kind of is.
So in the case of prototype, you can have an oak tree, a cherry tree, and a hash map of a certain set of type of trees. And then but the prototype, you can specify what type of tree you want, and it gives you a copy of that object. But the idea is that you have a finite set of type of trees, so prototypes, and you always get a copy of one of those prototypes. Just a second. Some programming languages actually use types, a type system, and JavaScript is one of them, that actually use the prototype design pattern for the type system. So the idea in Java, and that's why it's called the prototype design pattern, is that nothing is typed until you actually need a method out of that type. So the idea is really that on the fly, you can actually test, does this method have, I don't know, a quack? And then you see, oh yes, it does. It's the same idea. Go ahead. But maybe the parallel was not that good because, as I said, in this case, we are talking about the simplest case is that you have a finite set of objects and you want many different, many copies of this finite set of objects.
I had a question earlier about the initialization, okay. Comparing eager to lazy.
One second before you get into the singleton eager versus lazy. I just still want to ask Kevin if I covered all of the questions about prototype.
Yeah.
Okay.
You did. Thank you.
Welcome. So let's go back to singleton. What was the question about eager versus lazy?
Yeah, it was basically just checking to see when exactly does the eager initialization set a value for the variable?
When you actually compile and when you start the JVM, any static data field for the class that you are running the JVM on is created, because basically this statement is run before you actually start the main method. So you still do it at runtime, but before you actually you start running your program.
Great, thank you.
Welcome. Other questions?
So just one follow-up on that. As it looks like through the class main, it will look for the static objects and create those before it jumps into the main method?
All the static data fields are created before it actually starts running anything. So if you import, let's say, any class in your program, the current one that on which you run, you ran Java and main class, from the import statements, it immediately creates all of the static data fields of those classes. Because what it does, it compiles that specific class into the global segment of memory. And basically this is already put in that global segment of memory. Now, Connor, actually, I think it's even earlier than that, now that I think about, because Java is compiled into bytecode. So I'm 100% sure that when it actually compiles into bytecode, the class singleton in this case, it actually also creates this object and puts it in the class file, in the bytecode. So again, when you actually start the JVM, it loads into the global segment of memory the entire class definition, including the static fields. but I will have to make sure that that's the case. So I'm sorry, this is at very low level. It's at the level of how Java compiles into bytecode a source code. So I'm 100% sure, but let's say 99.9, that actually the object is created at compile time and is put in the class file. And in fact, when you run the JVM, it only loads that class into that class file into the global segment of memory.
Okay, gotcha. Is that like why an IDE will give you warnings if you have unused imports, because it will create those resources even though they're not needed?
I believe so.
Gotcha. Makes sense. Thank you.
Welcome. Okay. Any other questions? If not, then that's basically it. See you on Thursday. And if you have any questions about the project, I try to respond to questions about the project all the time on Piazza. And today there was a question that, in fact, it's a mistake of mine that the UML diagram does not have the password for lab employees. Actually, the question was, where are the lab employees stored? Because you have, if you look at the definition, you basically see that you have a login page. So where is this information stored? And I looked at the UML diagram and I realized that yes, collected by, it only has a, it's an employee ID. So it's a reference to an employee ID. So, but I wanted to basically tell you that there are two possible solutions that I can think of. One is to add the password into employee. So now this employee table is used both for the employees that are tested and the lab employees, basically those that log in into the application. Or you can basically have a different table, maybe even a better design of lab employees. And there you have the lab ID or employee ID or lab employee ID and the password. And really this collected by is a reference to lab employee lab ID. So yes, probably you need a separate table for that feature, because you basically have to implement a page that has a login page, no? So where is this password coming from? It's coming from the database, but it's really up to you if you want to add a field for password in employee, or you want a separate table for lab employees, those that do the entire data entry for our application. And you can go either design, either way, or even a different design altogether, because the entire grading of this project is on functionality. So this is a design that I made for this project, but you don't have to follow it as long as you implement the use cases that I describe in the requirements, that you have the login page, then that you have this web page with all of the functionalities like pool mapping and well testing and so on, that you can add in a pool multiple specimens, test barcodes, and then you can basically test them and state if that specific pool. So you, the reason why there are so many steps is that different employees do this pooling versus well testing. So usually it's like one employee that has, that puts in one pool multiple samples, now puts the pipette or whatever is called this container into a stack or a rack. And now that rack is passed to a different table or a different employee that fills the wells into this machine that does the testing. So it's really a UI application that is for people to actually see. And actually, now that I see that there is an employee login, probably the first design is the best, the one in which you have the password in the employee table, because you basically need to know the employee login, because the employee has to see his own results. No? But again, I'm testing on the functionality. So I don't mind if you change my design. I think my design is reasonable enough, especially this one, because now you have two different pages that are using the user and password to enter either the testing or the lab part or the employee part. Or you can use a mix of both. You can add a password here to employee, and you can use the lab employee for the login for lab employees. But in either case, the functionality is what I'm gonna look at when we look at your projects. Now, another thing that I want to say, and this probably will be something very good for many of you, is that I decided that initially the teams were of two, but I really think that at this time we should, because we have only 2 weeks left, 3 weeks, considering this week that is partial, that probably we can increase the teams to more than two. Let's say teams of four. And the idea being that if somebody disappears, there are still enough members in the team to finish the project properly. Okay. So I will update the drive. So every single TA has not only two fields, but four fields. And then you can basically paste your team members into the next cells. So don't touch the drive until Thursday. Discuss between yourselves if you want to form a team. And after all the teams, volunteer teams are formed, I'm going to assign everybody else into teams of four. So basically, even if some of you are not able to do much for this project, the team members can still succeed to deliver a project for themselves. Maybe not for the missing members, but for the rest of the members. Okay. So I hope that this is, the project was really intended for individual projects, but we are in a semester that is during a pandemic. So I think it's beneficial for everyone to work in a team, at least for the moment, and deliver whatever is possible within the rest of the semester.
Questions?
Yes.
So if we choose the first approach, let's say add the password, how do we distinguish between the lab employee and the Stony Brook employee? Can I assume the Stony Brook employee use?
I assume that there are two different pages for these two these two screens. I'm trying to find the screen.
For the database.
For the database, you don't really need to. I would assume that, at this point, I would say that it's fine to me if every employee can actually log in into the lab so they can do the pool mapping and all of this. I agree with you that probably a better design would be to have the lab employee as a separate table and maybe add the password in employee. And that's the final design that basically only lets lab employees to make tests and employees to check their own test.
Okay, so for now, there's no need for us to distinguish employee and Stony Brook employee. Is it okay if I assume Stony Brook employee, they use the email of with stonybrook.edu?
Fine with me.
Okay, thank you.
Because as you can see, I gave you multiple options in the design. And it's up to you which direction you go to.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome.
With the teams, do we have to have teams of four or can we stick with the partner?
You can do the project as individual, teams of two, teams of three, or teams of four.
Okay, perfect. Thanks.
Welcome.
For the already pre-existing teams, will you add more to the teams or?
You are free to add. So basically what I will create for every TA are two more columns, and let me do it now because it's easier to do it now. So insert one left and insert another one left. And this is teammate three. And this is teammate four. And even if like you want between yourself, I want to work with the next two students, you can just cut them and put them into the new locations. And now you have a team of four. So it's really up to you. Basically now it's available that you can make teams of four and you can re-team into teams of up to four. You can work in as individual. I've seen a lot of students that just want to develop the project on their own. Let me try to find, just look here. We have two individuals that say, two students, I want to work on this project alone. Fine with me, not a problem. So sizes of teams can be up to four. And I will create those additional columns for all of the TAs. And in the end, so at the end of this week, if I still see students that are not yet in any team, and they can put themselves as individuals if they want up to the end of the week. But if at the end of the week, I don't see these individuals grouped in any way, I will just assign them in a team of four. So if you want to work alone or you want to work with specific team members, please do it. Please update these files by the end of the week. Once the week is done, basically we'll just assign you into teams. Is that fine with everyone?
Perfect, thanks.
Thank you. Okay, that's all for today. See you on Thursday.
Thank you.
Thank you.